to make a good film that people look at and hopefully will be made more aware of the situation in Romania. I'm not some card-carrying, you know, flag-waving aid worker. That's not my job. But I would like to think that somehow I could make some change for the kids, you know, even small change for the children and the people who walking them through the film. I might have been a bit naive, but I thought kids only lived in sewers in places like Rio and Mexico and all that. Not that it's right that it happens, you know, because it's far away in South America or whatever, but I thought, I couldn't believe this was Europe. Everybody's talking about single currencies and EMUs and, you know, United Europe and all that, and in this far-flung, forgotten corner of Europe, and it still is Europe, these kids were living like this. But that's the first thing that struck me, that this is happening so close to home. They're coming out from underneath 40 years of communism, and there are huge, there's a huge fallout from a massive system like that. It's not just a change of government, it's a complete change in every single way of life that it's going to take them generations to get over. And these children are the children of a damaged generation. A lot of the children come from state orphanages, a lot of them come from homes where they say they were abused, where there was alcohol abuse, where it was violent homes, violent family background, whatever. And so these children are the product of a damaged generation, but they're gonna grow up damaged. We saw 6-year-old kids living on the streets. Not so long ago, they found a 3-week-old baby in a sewer. So these are the damaged children of a damaged generation, you know? And then it may go on and on, I don't know.
Making a documentary is a very evasive thing. I think I described it to you before as trying to catch eels while you're wearing boxing gloves. It's slippery, it's changing. There are constant issues that come up, and they sound like vaguely sort of filmy theories, but it doesn't mean nothing until you're faced with it. And I realise that I'm faced with decisions every day. I have footage of a girl cutting her arms to pieces with a piece of glass, because she wants to get into the cabinet to have a bath, and they won't let her in because she's not sick. So she says, I'll make myself sick, and she slashes herself and continually cuts herself and bangs the glass off the ground to make it sharper, to cut her arms, and a woman walks by and completely ignores her. Now, there's a reason why that child is doing that. Her name is Laura, and she's 14, and she's a prostitute. If I put that footage in, am I saying, this is Laura, this is all you're going to see of her, you'll never see her after, and you've never seen her before? Am I saying, this is Laura, and Laura slashes her wrists just to get a bat? Now, I don't want to do that to Laura, but the point I'm making is that I have a responsibility to these people. I feel I have a responsibility to these people. What I say about them, how I treat them, how I put them in or don't put them in to the film, what I cut in and what I cut out.
We shot this 8-year-old girl who was dying of AIDS in the Victor Babish Hospital. But I can't look at it and go, there's an 8-year-old girl dying of AIDS, and let myself get upset. I was very upset afterwards. But I don't know what it is. Maybe I am being cold, but there's a part of me goes, wide shot, close up, over the shoulder. How does this fit into the big story? Shoot it. I don't know. Maybe it does make me a heartless bastard. So there's a battle all the time. Your heart says, go in and put your arm around the child. Don't invade this child's privacy. She's an 8-year-old girl dying of AIDS. Have some respect. The other part of me says, sure, if you don't film it, go home. And I don't have an answer in the big picture, in the long run. All I know is that at the time, I'm there to film stuff. And I try and film as sensitively as I can.
So we've just been out to buy some milk in the shops, and they're dead grumpy in the shops.
and Rory got a receipt with many thanks written on it, just a bit of a bad joke really. And we saw this beggar, so I bought him a loaf of bread and two little pastries really, I don't know, sausage rolls or whatever. And it cost 40 pence for the loaf of bread and the two things, which is a bit weird because it's nothing, right? And he's in the rain and he's a beggar and of course you give him something. But if I was in Ireland, I wouldn't do that. I don't know why, but then I don't hug children on the streets in Dublin either. Watch the puddle. Oh. That was a puddle. So you do kind of feel like a bit of a hypocrite sometimes, you know, being all nice to these children and you know, buying bread and cakes and things for beggars, which you should do, because they are beggars and they have nothing and less fortunate than us and all that. But I do feel a bit of a hypocrite sometimes, because I wonder why am I not doing this back in Dublin. Just a thought.
Now and then you get this thing like, see, we were supposed to go and see this woman who has 8 children, one of them is 3 months old. She lives in this sewer in Bassarab, where there are 20 children, they even have beds. And she brings this baby out to beg on the bridge. Now, you don't want to see a baby on a bridge in minus 10. But there's another part of you that does, because you got to get it for the film, and you try and justify it, and you say, oh, well, if we weren't there, she'd bring the baby out anyway. But anyway, the baby wasn't there, and here we are drinking hot chocolate. And that's it, and they're still out there in the sewers. But I do feel guilty, because I'm becoming more and more cynical. I'm becoming more and more, fuck it, let's shoot it.
I'm getting more cynical and getting
more cold.
I'm getting more cynical about the film and going, there's been Germans here, there's been Danes, there's been TV crews from all over the world, the kids are camera aware. When you go down a sewer, you get condensation, they know what the score is. We're not the first, and no one seems to have made huge changes. So got less and less hope for the actual film in that way sometimes. So I'm getting more cynical the other way, I'm just going, forget the camera,
but
pick up the kid.
But I'm on Irish TV.
I know, but I'm still getting more and more cynical about it. But it's a bit weird. It was also so cold today. And to see kids going around in half a jumper and shoes that don't fit and thin socks. We've got thermals, t-shirts, I've got a sweatshirt on, I've got a fleece.
And we're still cold.
Down jacket, hat, scarf, gloves. They're not wearing a fraction of that. And they're out begging. And we're giving out about the cold, like it's unbelievable. Minus 10.
We just come back from Gregorescu for the second time. The sewer that Christy Oprah, the 10-year-old boy, was born to live in 6 weeks ago. In the middle of all this, I went over to speak to Veronica, who asked us, would we like to go to a shelter to visit an 8 and a 9-year-old girl who were raped and had been there for the last 6 months. Veronica sprung this on me and asked me, did we want to go to the cabinet with her to meet these girls? So, I'm at a crossroads. I'm wound up to do this thing about Gregorescu in the sewer. The crew is wound up, everybody's wound up, and all of a sudden this horrific thing that I can't comprehend gets loaded up, landed on my lap. And I have to make a decision on the spot. Whose disgusting story do I tell? The disgusting story of the 8 and 9-year-old girls who got raped? Or the disgusting story of Christy Oprah who got burnt alive in a sewer, 10-year-old boy. Which story can I tell quickest? Which one can I soundbite? Which life can I condense into 2 minutes? Because that's what it comes down to. I thought, well, I've already started to tell Christy's story, it's very important. This segment of the film will probably be cut down to, I don't know, 4 or 5 minutes. I can't do these girls justice in that time. So they got left. I said, no, sorry, can't go and see them. Got to tell Christy's story. We went down, we got an incredible shot, but it was the most disgusting experience I've ever had. It was horrible. It was absolutely horrible. You can't begin to describe this place. The heat, the stench, the claustrophobia, the dark, the cockroaches, the rats, the shit, the piss. Knowing that this 10-year-old went down there every night of his life, that's where he went to bed, in this hole under the ground, till somebody burnt him alive. If there's a hell on earth, that's where that young fella lived and died, in that sewer in the middle of the road, a poxy little hole 20 feet under the ground. No one ever called down to that young fella. No one ever shouted down, Christy, you all right?
it was more difficult for Suzanne than me coming back, because she came back on her own. She came back on the 23rd at the height of Christmas. I came back on the 27th, and Christmas was tailing off a bit, and the comparison between the excesses of Christmas and what you've just come from is quite striking. It took me a long time to settle down, because you come back home here and nothing means anything. Like, who gives a flying shite that the Late Late Show is on, or Dunne Stores are having a sale, or it's raining and it gets down to like 2 degrees? Who gives a flying fuck, really, when you've just come back and listened to stories about 10-year-old girls being raped, children being burnt alive, kids and paedophiles? It's not that people over here don't have a life and have a right to have to worry about the things they do, but when you've just come back from a situation like that, things seem very trivial. These are the broken ones. These kids are fucked. They're shattered. They're dysfunctional. They're damaged spiritually, physically, emotional. Nobody wants these kids. Nobody. People piss on them. And these people go out every day and they pick them up off the streets. They patched them up. They loved them. They creamed them. They kissed them. They hugged them. And then they do the same again the next day. They put so much of what we think or feel into perspective. Whether the film is good or bad, whether anyone watches it or not, I will never forget the children and the people who care for them.
Ireland isn't in the same situation. You know, we're meant to be going through an economic boom at the moment. I'd feel maybe more angry about kids on the streets here than I would over there, because there's absolutely no excuse for anybody to be on the streets over here. We're going through a period where there's been more money in this country than ever before, and yet I walk down a Collins Street over a Connell Bridge and there's a kid sitting there begging for money. Or you walk down one night and you see a homeless person sitting outside with a sleeping bag over them. Before I went over to Romania, I would be guilty of being one of those people probably, you know, of kind of looking at a person thinking, geez, well, what the hell are they doing there? Not thinking, why are they there, or what the hell are they doing there, i.e. like, why isn't somebody helping them? Whereas now I would do that more, and I would pass by somebody and think, geez, like, why are they there? Like, who is letting them be there? Why isn't there somebody doing something about it? But I suppose if I felt I should be doing something myself about it, you know what I mean? But then you kind of go, well, what can I do? And that's a really bad attitude to have, because a lot of Romanians have that attitude, well, what can I do? What can I do to change things so they do nothing?